Welcome back to Bombastic Nation and Ting. Back with some more vibes for all, you know what I mean? And this is a series I have started, and you know, it's a continuation of it and Ting, you know. So this one is The Bronze Age Collapse, The Wheel and the Rod, Extra History, you know what I mean? And Ting, listen, go ahead and share this video, like this video, and please, please, please comment below. Let me know what you think about it. Tell me stuff that's not included, stuff that is not what is actual facts or anything like that. Just comment below. Talk to a brother and thing, okay? Let's go ahead on YouTube and Simsima and see what go on here.
The wheel turns. Ages pass. Society becomes more advanced. Advancement leads to stability, to connection, to peace. But what happens when that's not true? Often when we think of the ancient past, the times before the Greeks and the Romans, we think of a barbaric or a primitive age. But that age of barbarism we think of actually followed the late Bronze Age collapse. Before the collapse, there were societies that wouldn't be rivaled again for half a millennium. So today, let's look at the technology, social policies, and political structures that made these kingdoms so impressive, so advanced, and that may, in the end, have led to their downfall.
Let's hear
it. First, we have to talk about bronze itself. As we touched on last time, bronze is an alloy of tin and copper, and most of the Bronze Age world was missing at least one of those components. This meant that Bronze Age civilizations had to trade. And I'm not just talking about small-time exchanging of shinies. We're talking a full-on, modern-day, our society requires trade to function type of trade. Everything from farming to war depended on bronze, much in the same way it depends on petroleum today. So a globalized, internationalized...
So back then, everything was dependent on bronze. I wonder if it was the same pattern of change, you know what I mean? Because now, people are trying to save the earth, so they want to change away from crude oil and all that kind of stuff to more efficient energy and stuff to stop hurt the world. Or the natural habitat that we live in. But think about it, you know what I mean? All the people who were dealing in copper, were they too saying, you know, it's gonna kill jobs if we stop using copper? Were they saying back then, you know? Well, what is it that there's a, so I live here in West Virginia, they have Friends of Coal. Did they have something equivalent to Friends of Bronze? Let's not let them kill our economy. And I wonder if that's how it happened. Let's keep watching.
System of trade sprung up around bronze, and with it came trade in almost every other good.
That's putting all your eggs in one basket. Thing.
It allowed a material standard of wealth, especially for the nobility, that was unrivaled anywhere in the world, except maybe similar. For China. This level of wealth wouldn't be seen again until the Classical Age. But it also meant that the kingdoms of the period were sort of like a Jenga tower. They stood tall, but if too many pieces got pulled out, that whole thing would come crashing down.
That's what it feels like these days.
So this interconnected system of trade, while enormously beneficial, may perhaps have also been one of the factors leading to the Bronze Age collapse. Next, let's talk war. Because in this period, the chariot was king. Almost all the major powers of the time built their armies around a chariot corps of one type or another. And here's the thing about chariots. They're really expensive and they're difficult to use. You can sort of think of them like
kind of like a lot of the military stuff these days. Apparently military stuff was expensive back then too. You know what I mean? That's just crazy. You know, in a more primitive sort of a way. We spend a ton of money on military stuff. Back then, they had the chariots, and that made them stronger than everybody else. So everybody had to get the chariots. It's kind of like the nuclear bomb. Everybody's got to get nuclear power. History repeating itself, but we think it's different because we have more technology now. But the humans behave the same.
Evil knights. It takes a lifetime of training to use these weapons, and maintaining them costs a small fortune. This meant that, like medieval knights, many kingdoms had a hereditary warrior class that was dedicated to doing just this. But what happens if you lose a ton of those guys at once? You can't just replace them. It takes years to train a guy up to the point where he can be proficient with a chariot. And what happens if your economy collapses? You no longer have the spare resources to maintain a caste whose singular role is to train to use some complex weapon, much less to pay artisans to build that weapon and technicians to maintain it. And so, while this particular engine of war was highly effective in a time when we hadn't really bred horses big enough to carry a man in full armor, it was also a liability. If things went really wrong, you could no longer maintain this highly sophisticated military machine. And then what happens if you need to defend yourself? What happens if you face some outside threat? What happens if you have to fight, but your whole conception of what an army is no longer viable? And so, again, this very weapon that made many of these states so dominant is perhaps one of the dominoes that sets us up for the Bronze Age collapse. And since we're talking about armies, let's talk about the governments they fought for, because these were incredibly organized, incredibly centralized governments. The level of central control in the late Bronze Age states is almost mind-boggling, far, far beyond the monarchies of the Middle Ages, perhaps even more than many modern states, which is important because due to this centralized control, many of the late Bronze Age kingdoms were structured as command economies. Every piece of grain, every dram of olive oil, every bar of bronze was tallied by the central government.
Wow.
Farmers were told what to plant, where to plant, and when.
Some people would call that communism. And I mean, notice say some people will. That's crazy because, you know, that's kind of like the idea they give you in this side of part of the world is what communism is. The government controls everything. You know what I mean? But then again, there's a fine line between that and dictatorship because in a dictatorship, the dictator controls everything.
Mines were state-run operations. And clearly this varies a bit from nation to nation, but from Egypt to Mycenae, you had top-down economies organized by the central authority. But what happens to a top-down economy when the top goes missing? If you're a laborer, and every year an official comes and gives you the seeds you're supposed to plant, and tells you when and where to plant them, what happens if that official just stops showing up? And this issue is compounded by two other pieces of technology. The first is irrigation. Bronze Age societies had very sophisticated irrigation systems. These were massive public works projects that took effort to maintain, and it took some element of centralized planning to build them efficiently to maximize crop yield. After all, having every farmer dig their own irrigation is going to get way messier than simply laying out 1,000 plots at once. This was great, as it meant high crop yields, which in turn meant that you could support big cities filled with artisans, priests, warrior nobles, and bureaucrats. And being able to support so many specialized positions in turn means more material wealth, a stronger government, and more opportunity for innovation. But what happens when that irrigation system gets destroyed, or simply stops functioning as efficiently? Well, then you've got a whole mess of people in your society who don't make food. And even ignoring the potential problems that arise from the fact that some of these people are very well armed, what happens when you can't support the non-food...
Man, this is something like modern day times, only with modern day weaponry and stuff like that. A society that's well armed, and they're not getting enough of the pie. Man, that sounds familiar, doesn't it? And we are talking about the collapse of the Bronze Age.
Food producers, but they're the planners who make this system run. The problem just compounds until you have a runaway collapse. And that's not the only problem caused by using advanced irrigation to support an ever-growing population. First, there's the obvious issue of overpopulation.
That's kind of like the infrastructure falling apart there. The main infrastructure is falling apart there. You know, the infrastructure that they based on. They base how they survive on is falling apart. And I mean, you know, the all the richer people could probably get stuff to trade, but the poor people can't afford to back then. So it's they're going to have to stand up and fight, I guess.
Even if your food supply can support a large number of people, can the rest of your infrastructure? There are health and sewage concerns. There's a question as to whether your economy can really employ all of these people. And of course, there's the question of whether you can keep these people from revolting. But there's also a less obvious problem with this type of intense agriculture, and that is soil degradation. Whenever you heavily farm an area, you leach out minerals, you create erosion, and you disturb the soil biology. Today, we do a great deal with modern farming techniques to avoid this, but the late Bronze Age was perhaps the first time that humans had farmed on this scale. And as we mentioned last time, while the Nile did bring with it rich silt that helped to restore the soil whenever it flooded, this just wasn't true of many of the other kingdoms. And so, silently, year after year, perhaps too slowly for anyone to really notice, crop yields decreased, and with them the ability to support the ever-growing population of the late Bronze Age states. And lastly, we have to talk about writing, because the Bronze Age world had come to rely on writing for everything from highly advanced record-keeping to international diplomacy. But a scribe is sort of like a knight of letters. They're amazingly powerful, but they're also expensive, and they require training from a young age. And though history shows that having the written word propels civilizations forward, and that every small increase in literacy ends up rippling out into large increases in the well-being of a society over time, even this idea that we usually think of as a purely positive, beneficial technology creates a potential liability. After all, if your whole society depends on written records and on record-keeping, what do you do when there's no one left to write the records? And so, piece by piece, the very complexity, the very advancedness that made late Bronze Age societies so impressive, so much better to live in than anything that followed for hundreds of years, also made them more fragile. As societies became complex, interweaving chains of trade, agriculture, education, and bureaucracy, the potential damage that could be caused by removing any link from those chains grew and grew.
Wow.
So join us next time as we look at what might have caused those chains to...
You see what's going on there, man? The very thing that they had to make them more efficient and have like a really good age, the Bronze Age, is the very thing that caused them to collapse. Excuse me. It's the very thing that caused them to collapse. That's crazy. You know, it's kind of like oil. You know, the very thing that's making these people rich off of the oil, which is the oil itself, is causing them to collapse slowly because the rest of the world is getting ready for some different type of energy. You know what I'm saying and thing? That's kind of interesting there, I think. You know, anyway, thank you guys for tuning in with me and thing. Hope you guys having a good week, weekend, whatever time of the frame you're in. Listen, take care of each other, all right? Cool runnings.